that people will fit could need to couple from 2.5 to 6. That was really interesting. In a fundamental way, you went too far, leading too much physics out. So here is two scientists that work at Yale Research from Bennett on the right, who mm-hmm. work in a laboratory, and he's a young fellow. And they asked the question at the time of, is there a fundamental limit to how efficient number crunching can be for being something? And when they asked that question at physicists, they ended up with a very surprising answer. They found the answer to be no. It turns out that number crunching can be the most thermodynamic reversible. He led to an exploration of what is the relationship between physics and information. And there was an out-famous conference that was going on the 90s in Yale Research at MIT at Endicott House, where his topic was exploring more details, and the plenary speaker was none other than Richard Feynman. And Feynman proposed in that conference that if you wanted to simulate nature, you should build a quantum computer. And I'm going to explain you what that means and how it's created and the problems that it will solve. But first, I've got to tell you what is the fundamental idea. The fundamental idea, just like we have bits in a classical world that can be a 0 or a 1, in a quantum computer, you have qubits, which stands for quantum bits. Now, the difference is that it can be a 0, a 1, or both at the same time. That exploits a principle of quantum physics called relativity. It sounds weird and crazy, but it's true. Now, to give you an ease that you should feel when we talk about quantum information and quantum computing, I'm going to give you a very simple example of an experiment that also happens to be true. So let's imagine that we're going to solve this problem. The problem involves, you have four cards. Three are identical, one is different, one is a queen. We shuffle the cards, and we put them face down. And the problem we're going to solve together is find a queen. We're going to be assisted by two computers. One is a classical computer, one is a quantum computer. So what we do is we turn them down, and we load them into memory. So we use four memory slots. The cards are identical, we put zeros. The one that has a queen is a one. Right, so the four slots are two zeros, and one is a one. We load them on the two computers. Now we have to write a program to find a queen, find the one. How would it be done practically? You would go and take a random number, you know where it is. You go look at that memory slot, see if it's a one, it's not, you go to the next slot, and so on and so on. On average, it would take you the equivalent of 2.5 turns to find it. It turns out that without two qubits on the computer for this problem, you can always solve it in one shot. So that's an easy feeling that you have now. Should be an explanation that quantum computer is not just about building a faster computer, it is building something that is fundamentally different than a classical computer. Now, a way to think about it, an abstraction of it, is that a quantum computer is always going to have a classical computer next to it. They have to go together. So you have a classical set of bits, like the problems that you're trying to store. And what a quantum computer is allowed you to do is to store the exponential number of bits. It's 2 to the n, where n is the number of qubits that you have. So now we have a relatively small quantum computer, 50 qubits. But just think of the number that by the time you have 50 qubits, you have 2 to the 50 states. That's a phenomenally large number. But in the end, after you store the number of states, you go back to a classical output, a string of 0 and 1 to the interface to the normal computer. So why is this interesting? And I think this audience, I don't need to, explain in great detail, what exponential mean and why 2 to the 50 is a very large number. But it's still, I think it's an interesting way to communicate the power of this, and I like to map it to some problems. But I'd like to go after this apocryphal story that actually IBM used in the 1950s to explain to people the power of exponential. And it had to do with the person who invented chess that goes to the emperor and says, well, here's a wonderful game, and asks, what do you want in return? And the person who invented is, give me a ring of light on this first day for the first square, and the second day, you give me twice as much on the first square, third day, you give me, twice as much as the day before. And the emperor agrees, probably, that's quite reasonable. And after a week, you only have 127 grains. After a month, you have more rides than you'll be in your lifetime for sure. But just by the time you get to the end of the chessboard, you have more rides than Mount Everest. So there are a large number of problems in the world that have these characteristics that they blow up exponentially. And the real secret in the world of computing is that we obviously talk a lot about all the things that computers can solve and solve a lot of things. But then there's a lot of things that computers cannot solve. And they're interesting. They cannot solve it now, nor ever. And the reason is because they have this exponential built into them. So take an example, this very simple equation, factoring. So if I have a number,